Hello and welcome back to our course Data Analysis for Astronomy and Physics, Lecture 15, Introduction to Neural Networks. In this final section of our course, we will talk about neural networks. We will start by discussing the simplest cases, the single layer perceptrons, and apply those to a very naive case of image classification. We will then, in a second section, move on and extend this to multi-layer perceptrons. In a third section, we will introduce and generalize the whole concept and then show quantitatively how neural networks are trained to determine the optimal set of weight coefficients for our system. And in a fourth section, we will discuss example application of modern neural networks. In order to give proper credits, this lecture is mostly based on a very exciting and really great blog article at Gorman Analysis. And it's called Introduction to Neural Networks. So please check that out. That's a really great source. Okay, so we will start with a simple motivational problem. And when we look at these grayscale images, so we call this image, it's basically a 2x2 image, a 2x2 grid of pixels. Every pixel has an intensity value between 0, corresponding to white, and 255, corresponding to black color. Our goal now is to build a model that properly identifies images with a pattern that looks like a stairs. So, for example, here the bottom right, this is how a stairs look like, or this one, or this one, but obviously not this one or the others. So to be more precise, a stairs pattern corresponds to two dark pixels in the bottom row and one dark and one bright pixel in the top row. For that, we import a training data set that consists just of a number of example images of these 2x2 images that either contain a stair or not, and that are properly classified. So we also import the classification true or false, depending on whether it's a stair or whether it isn't. So, just to look into this again in more detail, this is an example from the data that is a true classified stairs. And here you have the numerical values of this 2x2 grid, basically a 2x2 matrix. The individual pixels are numbered beginning from the top left pixel, being pixel 1, 2 is the top right, and then 3, 4 are the two bottom pixels. We start by creating a couple of helper functions to visualize the data and randomly pick entries from our data. For example, a function that plots the numerical values. This is the number here, these are the numerical values of the pixels, this is the corresponding image, and this is the classification. So again, recall that small numbers correspond to white colors. So this is pixel 1, white to the top left, and this is almost black, corresponding to bottom left, which is the pixel number 3. And we will start with the really most simple approach, which is called a single layer perceptron. A perceptron uses a weighted linear combination of inputs and computes a prediction score from these weighted inputs. And if the prediction score exceeds a certain threshold, this perceptron returns 1 or true, otherwise it predicts false. So mathematically, this is a piecewise definition. F of fx equals 1 if this weighted sum of the inputs x1 to xn being larger than the threshold or 0 otherwise. Graphically, this can be shown here with this graph. We have here the perceptron that takes 4 input channels x1 to x4 that are weighted with a weight w1 to w4 plus some constant term, bias term, and the input to this perceptron is the x values and the b and the weights, and the output is given either 1 or 0 depending on the threshold. To start with an example, we use the following weights for the pixels 1, 2, 3, and 4. We will note that the first two, the top row gets negative pixels, positive row gets positive pixels, and we have a bias term that is like this. I create two functions here to compute from a list of pixel values and weights and a bias term the linear combination, so that's the scalar product here plus the bias term, and then decide whether this perceptron returns 0 or 1. And the result function just shows the result together with the figure and the classification. So we start with these weights here, and we insert a list of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of our images, and I feed these pixel values to our perceptron with our initial chosen weight vector. And this is the result. I plot here the value output, the numerical output value, and whether this then classifies as stairs or not. Okay, so what we note is that, for example, here the last four images are classified as stairs. So for these three, that's a very good classification. For this one, one could argue whether a pixel value of 61 qualifies as here producing a stair. And the top two here are not qualified as stairs. So this is already pretty nice. When you look again, then we were chosen our threshold such that when this linear combination is positive, we return true. If it's negative, we return false. And that's also the reason for the bottom row weights to be positive, because we will, if the bottom row is dark, this will be a large number times positive weights. And if the top row is white, it will be a small number times negative weights. We'll try to compensate this a little bit. So all these stairs patterns have darkly shaded pixels in the bottom row that support the larger positive coefficients for 3 and 4 pixels, for pixels 3 and 4. We have a few problems. The output should be interpreted as the certainty or the likelihood that the pattern actually shows stairs. And purely from a mathematical point of view, nothing prevents our output function to become larger than 1, so it won't be a likelihood. And our model can't capture nonlinear relationships. So when we look, for example, at these two examples, let's look at these two pixels here. this one clearly not being a stairs, but when we increase the darkness or decrease the brightness of this pixel by 60, so from 0 to 60, it starts to look like a stairs. When we increase this even further, it really looks like a stair. So in both examples, we just increased the value of pixel 3 by 60. To see the effect of this increase of our perceptron output, we just have to multiply the weight 3 by the delta, and this is 0.01. However, when we look at the change from here to here, this is dramatic because this clearly changes the pattern from non-stair to stairs, while this is a purely qualitatively a less severe step. So our output should increase more strongly in the example B compared to example in the example A compared to example B. And this is of course due to the linearity in our linear combination function Y. So we started by providing the weights, and now we would like to figure out what are good weights. And for this we built a cost function of the form model minus data squared, summing over all data. And the model is again the output of our perceptron. And the data is a classification of 0 or 1 from our training data. So creating the cost function here, we can then numerically minimize this cost function. We limit the range of our weights a little bit. And after a short time, this is a simple function, we find a set of weights and a bias value that minimizes our cost function. So comparing this with our initial guess, we find, okay, all the two top row weights are also negative, the bottom row values are positive, and we get a somewhat different bias. But we can now compare the performance of our weights. And here this is our newly found weight vector applied to a random selection from our data and compared with the initial classification. So what we see is that in some cases our classification here seems to be worse than the initial classification. However, in other cases, our classification seems to be more correct than the initial one. Okay, now we mentioned a few problems, for example, the problem of linearity, and to address this, we will modify our perceptron a little bit and wrap the output within a certain function that introduces non-linearity, and we choose the sigmoid function. The sigmoid function looks like this. It is bound between 0 and 1. This is the formula. So once C is positive, we will have a value above 0.5. If it's negative, we will be below 0.5. So as a result, no matter how large C, so we will plug in our result of the linear combination here, no matter the value of the linear combination, the result will be bound between 0 and 1, and then we can interpret this as a probability of a binary event. So this is how our new model looks like. We have our function C being the linear combination of the weighted input plus the bias And this is fed to the sigmoid function. And we will have y hat now as this, giving us the output. The threshold now needs to be adapted. So if y hat is larger than 0.5, we say it's a true identification, and at zero it's false. Then we modify also our perceptron formula, so where we feed our linear combination now to the sigmoid and change also our plotting. When we do so, we test our function again, here with this guessed set of weights and with this bias, and when we do this, this is the result. So for these six images, we identify those two not as stairs. We also identify this not as stairs, and the bottom three are identified as stairs. And we could argue these two identifications. The value of y hat is now always below 1 or between 0 and 1. And when we interpret this as probability, then this has a 75% probability of being stairs, while this, according to our perceptron, should have a probability of 100%. Now, this is for the probability argument. When we look at the second concern regarding the linearity, so again, we change this value by steps of 60 in our example A and B. And when we feed the outputs here, then we see that when we move from the first case to the second case, our y function, so the output of the sigmoid, changes by almost 90%, while when we move from B to the initial and the second, we only have an increase in 10% certainty. So this seems to provide what we wanted to have, namely a non-linearity in the response of our perceptron. And this is, of course, due to the increase here, depending on the value of C. And we see that from here to here, this gives a really strong increase, while from here to here, this gives just a smaller increase in the result of the sigmoid. We can also now try to find the best set of weights ourselves. And we find this set here. Again, the first two weights are negative, the bias is negative, and the bottom weights are positive. Comparing the performance from our classification on the left to the initial classification on the right, we now see that we are in very good agreement, at least for these randomly chosen members of our data. There are still some remaining issues, and for example, our linearity in the weights will favor darkly shaded stairs because this corresponds to larger values of x, so we are adding up larger numbers. But what if we want to identify very lightly shaded stairs? Imagine one very white pixel to the top right and all the other pixels are slightly gray, and it is still stairs, but we wouldn't identify this properly. And our model does not account for variable interaction. So for example, assume that the bottom row of an image is black. Now if the top left pixel is white, then any darkening of the top right pixel should increase the probability of stairs. If the top left pixel is black, darkening the top right pixel should decrease the probability of stairs. So in other words, increasing x3 should potentially increase or decrease our value of y depending on the values of the other. So this is an interdependence from the input data that is impossible to do in our current model, just because we just have this simple linear combination. So for example, let's imagine that we have our bottom row black, the top left pixel is white, and when we now darken the top right pixel, you see that our sigmoid function doesn't change significantly, even though we could argue that this is still a stairs. And when we increase R1 further, you see that the probability goes down, even though this is even more a stair than this.